Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 10406 in the name of Marie Goujon on celebrating the resilience of Scotland's food and drink sector. I invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I call on the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move the motion around 13 minutes. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm really grateful for the opportunity of this debate, which coincides with Food and Drink Fortnight, to highlight to Parliament the enduring value of our vibrant food and drink sector in Scotland, to our national and local economies, as well as to our communities. Scotland produces some of the best and most recognisable food and drink in the world, and we must all recognise how vital it is to protect this iconic industry. Now, firstly, to place the sector in context, food and drink is Scotland's biggest export, second only to energy. In 2020, the sector generated a turnover of almost £15 billion and £5.4 billion in gross value added. In 2021, Scotland had around 17,450 food and drink businesses, employing around 129,000 people. We should all take a moment to reflect on the sheer scale of the sector and its contribution to our overall economy. Vibrant and one-time seamless trade with the EU has also been extremely important for exporters as well as consumers, as approximately 23% of the food eaten in the UK is imported from the EU. We also mustn't lose sight either of the fact that food is a fundamental need for all of us. Our farmers, fishers, crofters, food manufacturers and producers are at the heart of our rural, coastal and island communities, and they contribute to Scotland's £15 billion food and drink industry. And they all play a vital role in keeping this dynamic, complex, at times fragile and highly interconnected sector operating to supply our food each and every day. They should be commended for their efforts as they continue to show that admirable resilience in the face of continued shocks like Brexit, climate change and the Ukraine conflict. The value of the food and drink sector cannot be overestimated, and this Parliament debated only in May the importance of our overall food security, including in the face of real and significant challenges. That debate highlighted that supply chains and sustainable food supplies are really coming more to the fore in public consciousness, and that disrupted supply chains, including, for example, as a result of climate volatility, are something that we are likely to see more and more of in the future. Yes, I will.
Rachel Hamilton.
For taking the intervention. Why does the Cabinet Secretary's party want to put a barrier between Gretna and Berwick, which would actually be disruptive to 60% of Scottish exports?
Cabinet Secretary.
We are not the government that's putting barriers anywhere in when it comes to trade, and it's the UK government that have done that through their determination to pursue a hard Brexit. And so, Presiding Officer, while I want to focus my opening remarks today on celebrating the successes of the sector, it's not possible to do that without first highlighting some of the fundamental challenges and referring to some key facts. In and of themselves, they serve to illustrate the resilience, versatility, and the sheer ability of the sector to bounce back in the face of so many challenges. Now, it's a fact that the hard Brexit pursued by the UK government and its lingering effects has weakened our food and drink sector in so many ways. It's disrupted supply chains, helped drive up food price inflation, and led to trade deals which failed to prioritise Scottish interests. It's a fact that Brexit has caused significant labour recruitment issues for the food and drink sector. It's a fact that Brexit has impacted on our trading relationship with the EU, one of our most important trade partners and a major agri-food producer. Food imports from the EU into Scotland were down 18% in 2022 compared to 2019, and this slowdown is particularly acute for fruit and vegetables, down 50%, and fish and seafood, down 66%. Many Scottish food exports to the EU are also down, including a 38% fall in fruit and vegetable exports between 2019 and 2022. It's a fact that our world-renowned Scottish salmon sector, the UK's number one food export, is being hampered by the UK government's continued delays to its digitisation programme. It's a fact that recent research by the London School of Economics suggests UK households have paid £7 billion to cover the cost of post-Brexit trade barriers on food imports from the EU, increasing average household food costs by £250 since December 2019. And it's a fact that our agricultural sector, which underpins much of our food and drink, has been directly impacted by the lack of long-term future funding certainty. Our seven-year EU cap budgets have been reduced to yearly allocations from HM Treasury, only guaranteed for the current UK parliamentary term, not at the moment. The overwhelming majority of people in Scotland, of course, didn't vote for any of this. The ongoing economic damage of a UK Brexit-based economy demonstrates the importance of setting out an alternative, better future for Scotland. That is what the Scottish Government is doing through our Building a New Scotland papers. We'll continue with this work, including a series of forthcoming economics-themed speeches to demonstrate how, with independence, we can build a stronger economy, taking advantage of key sectors such as food and drink. Now, I've urged the UK Government repeatedly to address the cumulative impacts I've just outlined on the sector. I further highlighted my significant concerns about new free trade agreements with New Zealand and Australia. The UK Government's own impact assessment highlighted that those deals would be detrimental to the agri-food sector. In stark contrast to that, an equivalent EU-New Zealand trade deal has been secured, but not at the same expense to domestic EU producers, particularly for beef and lamb, which it has protected so much better. And this serves to illustrate that better arrangements are indeed possible. Yes.
Finlay Carson.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what she's doing to ensure that the critical mass of the beef production in Scotland is protected?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member will no doubt be aware of our commitments and into supporting our livestock sector in Scotland, our commitment to supporting food production, which we're continuing to do through direct payments. And I've already made that commitment clear in this debate and in previous debates in this chamber. Now, when it comes to the impacts of the trade deals that I've just outlined, you don't just need to take my word for it. An independent report by the Anderson Institute on the potential impact on Scottish agriculture of trade deals between the UK and Australia, New Zealand, Canada and the Gulf Cooperation Council concluded that the current UK government trade approach will adversely affect our beef and sheep sectors, sectors vitally important to our rural and island communities. We can only hope that the UK government will begin to listen to the concerns of the devolved governments, industry and consumers. For example, I've asked the UK Government to use the opportunity of the recent independent review of labour shortages in the food chain in England to work together with the devolved governments on its response. The sector has long highlighted to the UK Government that urgent changes to the immigration system are needed to address post-Brexit labour shortages. It is already disappointing that this review focuses only on England, but I believe it presents us with a watershed moment to work together to support the sector. And so I've urged the UK Government to take a collaborative and evidence-based approach to its response and on immigration policy in particular. Now, while it is important to recognise these challenges, I don't want to dwell only on the negatives. As the end of Food and Drink Fortnight approaches, I want to use the opportunity of our debate today to celebrate the sector, to highlight its value to us all and to pay tribute to its successes. Food and Drink Fortnight is a reminder to all of us that there's an entire world of flavours and stories to discover right here in Scotland on our doorstep, the theme of this year's campaign. Scotland Food and Drink has worked closely with regional food groups and ambassadors to promote a lineup of regional events over the last few weeks, as well as spotlighting produce from across Scotland that stocked everywhere from restaurants and bars to delis and markets. I've undertaken a number of engagements myself, from Leith to the Outer Hebrides, to witness this firsthand. And I hope that the fortnight will help to encourage more and more people to explore the fantastic products that are available right on their doorsteps. Now, as I've highlighted, the fact that we've left the EU has caused significant problems for our farmers and food and drink industry. And during the last 5 years, the industry has, of course, also had to deal with the pandemic and an ongoing cost crisis. Yet fundamentally, the food and drink sector is already a Scottish success story. As an employer and an exporter, they make a major contribution to the Scottish Government's missions of opportunity, equality and community. The Scottish Government is determined to work with the sector to help it succeed further. We provided the industry with £15 million to support its recovery plan to tackle challenges posed by Brexit and the pandemic. I need to make some more progress. Now as markets reopen and the industry looks to grow in a changed world, we've added to that support with a further £5 million towards year one implementation of the new food and drink strategy, Sustaining Scotland, Supplying the World. That funding will, among other things, help us to showcase the industry to domestic and international buyers. It will support our efforts to train and reskill people, and it will enable us to share insights and develop solutions for reducing greenhouse gas emissions. The new strategy outlines a vision of Scotland as the best place in the world to own, operate and work for a food and drink business, to be renowned as a world leader in sustainable production and responsible growth, where resilient businesses across the entire supply chain can prosper. The strategy has 8 distinct enablers for growth, all of which are significant and worthwhile, and I want to highlight 2 themes which I do think are particularly important: the ambition that it shows and the emphasis on collaboration. The strategy focuses on resilience, sustainability and growth, since it recognises that all 3 are essential to the future of the industry. It aims to ensure the industry can withstand shocks, and it embraces and benefits from the journey to net zero. In relation to growth, the strategy sees major opportunities for producers in Scotland to increase their sales here at home, in the rest of the UK and right around the world. It aims to ensure that the food and drink sector in Scotland grows more strongly than in competitor countries of similar size. The Scottish Government welcomes that level of ambition. However, we recognise that this strategy and the Government's support for it will only have the impact we want it to have if we continue to collaborate. We need to work together if we're going to attract a skilled workforce, improve productivity, reduce our carbon emissions and market ourselves globally. And so the strategy sets out short, medium and long-term goals developed in collaboration with food and drink producers and others such as research institutions that have a focus on stability amidst that global turbulence. Overall, the aim of this 10-year plan with industry is that our approach and funding will help to shift the dial on food and drink sector growth in Scotland. In keeping with this collaborative theme, we've confirmed just last week in our programme for government a range of measures where we'll be working very closely with the sector to enhance our support. For example, we'll be developing our approach to future farming activity through engagement with key stakeholders to identify potential opportunities to increase sustainable production and markets for poultry and eggs, venison and seed potatoes. And we've also said that we'll host an international food summit that will help to bring much of our work together, including with industry, to support further the promotion of Scotland's food and drink. And sorry, I'm just coming to a close. Presiding Officer, I want to conclude by taking a moment to acknowledge and extend my gratitude to each and every business and individual who works to help drive the growth of local sourcing and to keep this country fed. Producers large and small, from farmers to fishers to regional food groups and dedicated retail and food service buyers. It's their tireless efforts that encourage people to buy Scottish produce, and it's their dedication that helps us to build a brighter future for our rural communities and islands. And their passion for local produce and experiences inspires us all to take pride in our unique national heritage. And Presiding Officer, with that, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. A gentle reminder to those who haven't already pressed their buttons but are looking to speak in the debate to press the buttons as soon as possible. And I call Rachel Hamilton to speak to and move Amendment 10406.2 around 9 minutes, Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I draw members to my register of interest as a Director of a Small Business in the Borders. I'd like to join the Cabinet Secretary first and foremost in celebrating our food and drink sector today, although it did take her over 7 minutes to get there. We have world-class food and drinks producers in the country, and we should champion the people who make the industry such a success for Scotland and such an asset. It is right that we take the time to celebrate them today, but the industry requires more from us than just celebration. It requires support, it requires certainty to plan for their future, it requires a workable and practical agricultural bill. The food and drink sector has shown an enormous amount of resilience, as the Cabinet Secretary said, through global challenges like the pandemic and the economic impact of Russia's war in Ukraine. Resilience is rightly the focus of today's debate. Despite no mention of farmers in either the Labour or the SNP motion, and barely a peep in the earlier programme for government from the First Minister, in recent years, farmers, the beating heart of the £15 billion food and drink industry, have overcome damaging outbreaks of disease amongst livestock, such as avian flu, and dealt with severe water shortage that hit their crops hard. Yet those charged with the task of feeding the nation continued to be left in the dark over future support. The dither and delay over the new agricultural bill is wreaking havoc on the industry, and we have to take our responsibility to them more seriously, give them clarity that they need quickly. Overcoming natural difficulties is one thing, but the biggest challenge they face is one entirely of this SNP Green government making. And farmers aren't the only ones waiting until the cows come home. We await the fate of Scotland's short-term let sector, which faces death by SNP green red tape, a sector that is entirely integral on providing good food and drink and supporting Scotland's important tourism sector. Scotland's fishing communities have also faced a turbulent year at the hands of this government, having failed to learn the lessons of an 11-week ban, a fishing ban imposed on Clyde communities without consultation or warning. The government's headlong rush into banning fishing in almost half of Scotland's waters would have been a complete disaster for our fishing industry. Sustainable fishing practices in Scotland have seen stocks of many of our favourite kinds of fish rebound in the recent years. Hard-working fishermen are landing thousands of tonnes of healthy, high-protein fish every year, some of it even carbon neutral. And already squeezed for space in the marine environment, the HPMA plans would have decimated this industry, decimated coastal communities, on which so many of Scotland's coastal communities have relied on for centuries. We expected these plans to be scrapped, but they, in my view, presiding officer, have merely been postponed. And until these plans are scrapped completely and the government go back to the drawing board, the fishing industry will continue to worry about its future. Our drink sector has faced an equally difficult period, having been forced to adapt to legislative changes like minimum unit pricing and the threat of unworkable deposit return scheme, or preventing whiskey distilleries from painting their names on the side of the outside of their walls. From now, both the fishing industry and the drinks sector have been saved by the strength of their voice in opposing these plans and the legislative incompetence of this government, who are trying to implement such imposition. However, my intention today is not to dwell on where the Scottish Government has let down the food and drinks industry, but to talk about the opportunities that lie ahead if we start to get things right. At the Royal Highland Show this year, I launched my plans for Scotland's food future. This policy paper has been welcomed across the board. It's a positive step from stakeholders talking about the policy proposals that are in this paper, from farmers to wholesalers and vet suppliers to council officers. My plan would support Scotland's rural communities to secure jobs and livelihoods and a viable future for our food and drinks producers alongside farmers, crofters and fishermen. And it would place food production at the heart of the new agricultural bill while investing in producers to keep food prices affordable for consumers. It would allow farmers to produce more top quality food right here in Scotland and bring in more local jobs for processing and transport and abattoirs. It would bolster support for technology and innovation to help improve the UK's world leading standards on health, the environment and animal welfare. These plans include key policy objectives like helping councils support local producers by introducing 60-60 targets. 60% of food procured by every mainland local authority from within 60 miles of a local authority area. Buying locally means stronger local economies, healthier foods and less imports, leading to lower emissions, which is what we all want to achieve. I believe this was an opportunity missed in the Good Food Nation Bill by the Cabinet Secretary, and key amendments that would have supported a lot of the policy were missed. Yes, of course.
Emma Harper.
I thank Rachel Hamilton for taking an intervention. I'm not sure if you've mentioned the word Brexit yet, but I'm just wondering if you are going
through
to
the
address
chair, please,
the issue
Harper.
Of how Brexit has failed our farmers across the UK and Scotland, of course.
Rachel Hamilton,
well,
the time
of
back.
Course, Emma Harper continues to talk down her constituency in Dumfries and Galloway. And the SNP would be better to support farmers, give them clarity over their future. Yeah. They would be better to realise the opportunities that have been afforded by trade deals and what we are able to do now we have left the EU. I would like Emma Harper to go and speak to her constituents to ask them if they are holding them back by aligning with Europe and not adopting new technology with gene editing. We all share our food heroes, and I am lucky in my Borders constituency to have so many fantastic producers, from Hardy's Mill Beef, Peelham Farm, so many outstanding local businesses, from the bread maker in Coldstream, Hunters the bread makers in Hoyk to Selkirk Distillery, the Borders Distillery and Jacopazzi's ice cream in Eyemouth. I'm biased and my colleagues may protest, but in my books, the Borders produces the best food in the country. And wouldn't it be great to see more Borders produce in schools, in hospitals, in council canteens, as I'm sure that many people here today share their own passion in their constituencies. The paper that I discussed also discusses how gene editing could enable farmers to naturally to improve the reliability and nutritional value of the food they produce while reducing the resources required to produce it. This technology would cut emissions. It would boost yields. As my colleagues will come on to this, in particular Finlay Carson, this technology would make a real difference to people's lives every day. It would allow farmers to pass on their savings and efficiency to allow them to be part of the solution to tackling poverty. The improved yields would reduce our reliance on costly foreign imports flown in from abroad whilst helping local businesses expand, creating more jobs for local communities. And the only way that stands in the way of this innovation is ideological opposition, now that even the European Union has moved on from. If this government wants to show its appreciation to our food and drink population, I can think of no better way than supporting our plans, the Conservative plans. We actually have a plan rather than any of these benches over here who have no plan, no clarity. They need to bring forward a genetic technology bill. They need to bring forward agricultural policy. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scotland's food and drink sector is pivotal to our economy, to our national economy, to our local economy. And despite enduring recent global challenges and economic mismanagement by this SNP Green lot, then let's celebrate their resilience during Scottish Food and Drink Fortnight by eating some local produce, delicious local produce, on our own doorsteps. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. Could I ask you to move your amendment, please?
Oh, I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Much obliged. Thank you very much. I now call on Rhoda Grant to speak to and move amendment 10406.1, around 7 minutes. Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I move the amendment in my name. That saves me forgetting later on. I really welcome this debate because it underlines the importance of the food and drink sector to Scotland. And I believe we should have four pillars that underline our production system. We need food security. 60% of our food is home produced. We're importing 40%. It needs to be climate friendly. It needs to provide a fair deal for workers. And we need to recognise it as the economic driver it is. With regard to food security, it is absolutely unacceptable that we have so many people dependent on food banks. The Trussell Trust told us that 259,744 food parcels were delivered in 22-23, and that's a 50% increase from 17-18. That's a disgrace. The Good Food Nation Bill, now an act, could have dealt with that. It should have enshrined the human right to food, and it should have empowered Food Scotland to implement that human right to food. I'm still determined to bring forward a bill that will do that so that we can be freed from the scourge of food banks and food insecurity. And that food insecurity and food banks and food poverty actually are a problem for us all, because we see the health issues that are being raised because of the lack of nourishing food. We're seeing obesity rates increase. We're seeing the return of diseases such as rickets coming back into our community. That is a cost to all of us, and that is because people cannot afford good, nutritious food. The Scottish Government talked about a plan to end food banks. That was last year. We're still waiting for the promised plan, hopefully before this winter, so that we can end people's dependence on the dehumanising process of going to a food bank. And I would urge all MSPs who see the obscenity of a rich country having families dependent on food banks to join me to bring an end to that. The war in Ukraine has also shown us how important our national food security is. We need to produce more than 60% of our own food for our national security, to cut carbon miles, for local economies. And if we looked at things like procurement, local procurement, this is a Labour policy to make sure that 50% of food procured by local public bodies should be coming from local procurement. And we need to do that to support our farming industry and our food and drink sector. With regard to the climate, we have a lot to offer. Our animals are grass-fed, which actually sequestrates carbon. Putting higher standards on our own grass-fed animals in order to cut the number we produce, that then means importing others from elsewhere, which are not having the same, taking their responsibilities towards the climate so seriously, actually is counterproductive. We need to look at innovation, of course, because we need to reach net zero both within our food production as well. So we need to make sure that we have things like carbon recycling, something that the Rural Committee looked at quite recently. And we also need to make sure that we have the right pipeline jobs, things like abattoirs, local abattoirs that allow us to make use of local produce as close to home as possible. That cuts transport, but we need to make sure those pipeline jobs are there to support our industry. With regard to fishing, we need to make sure that we are fishing sustainably. We need to use our powers over our seas to ensure that we have selective gear. We need to cut bycatch, and where there is bycatch, it needs to be landed and used because we can't afford the waste. And we need to make sure that policies such as the HPMAs that targeted the most sustainable fisheries are not going to come forward again. We also need to look at the people who produce our food and drink. The Bakers Union talked about many of their members depending on food banks, and that's surely wrong. People who are baking and producing our food are themselves having to go to food banks to eat. And there's also insecure working. We need to have a new deal for working people, a ban on zero-hour contracts, outlawing fire and rehire, and producing security at work, giving people the full rights from day one. And that's why how we deal with a labour shortage, because if we make that job more attractive, we make sure it is better paid, then we will get the workers to carry out those jobs. We also have to remind ourselves that food and drink is so important to the economy, £8.1 billion in exports. Many of us know that Scotch whisky is responsible for much of this, and I'm very lucky representing the Highlands and Islands and indeed much of the whisky producing parts of Scotland, and certainly the best whisky producing parts of Scotland. But we've also got other quality food. I need to mention Orkney cheese, Shetland lamb, Stornoway black pudding, to name a few, that have protection because they are so important. This sector employs 48,000 people, and and indirectly supports another 300,000 jobs. It is of critical importance to our country. I'm disappointed that this debate seems to have come down between Brexit and not Brexit. Brexit, of course, brought issues and problems, but we need to try and find ways through them. And the Scottish Government cannot just simply blame Brexit for their own shortcomings. We need to look and give consideration, of course, to gene editing as well, and see what benefits it could bring to food production. We need a joint... I am in my last minute.
I can give you a little bit of time, but not an awful lot.
Enough for...
A brief intervention. Rachel Hamilton.
I agree with Rhoda Grant. The SNP would have us believe that Europe is, that Europe is close to us. But Scottish salmon exports in the beginning of 2023 increased by 9%. So I totally agree with you about their arguments around Brexit.
Rhoda Grant.
I don't think I said that Brexit was a good thing, far from it. Yeah, exactly. We need to be able to export, and at the moment we're importing without barriers, but not exporting without barriers, and we need to sort that out. We need an all-round policy. People talked about the agriculture bill. We've got the human right to food. We've got a good food nation plans coming up. We need a joined-up policy, presiding officer, because the Scottish Government doesn't use their powers to the maximum. They've missed an opportunity to join up food and drink policy. Mm. They've missed the opportunity to enshrine the right to food in the Good Food Nation Act, and they've made no progress in dealing with food poverty. Opportunity squandered. They could have improved the nation's health and economy. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Ms Grant. I now call Beatrice Wishart, around 6 minutes, Ms Wishart.
Thank you, presiding officer. Scotland's food and drink sector, as has been mentioned by other speakers, deserves praise up and down the food chain, from field to fork, for its resilience. This has been especially acute in the past few years with Brexit, COVID, the cost of living crisis battering the sector from all angles, and the challenges of climate change. A combination of the uncertainty after Brexit, the pandemic, and most acutely, Russia's invasion of Ukraine have pushed prices up. Worldwide basic ingredients have shot up in cost due to less availability, with disruption to growing and distribution out of Ukraine. Rightful anti-invasion boycotts of energy produced in Russia has impacted European farmers and growers, as well as the supply chain, with increased energy and fuel costs. A spike in fertiliser costs up to 180% year on year between April 21 and 2022 is a stark figure illustrating the challenge. We're beginning to see prices fall, but not before NFU Scotland highlighted the astronomically high profits in the fertiliser industry. I agree with the government's motion that the hard Brexit negotiated by the UK government has created some serious long-term harms, including labour shortages, new barriers to trade for Scottish food and drink exporters, and contribute to inflation rises in food and supply chain costs. It's ironically due to the preparation for such a hard Brexit that the sector was able to be so resilient during the COVID-19 pandemic. We cannot overstate the success of the sector during the COVID emergency, and nor can I appropriately convey the thanks of people across the country to all those involved who managed to keep food on the shelves during that fraught time. The hard Brexit negotiated will continue to impact on the sector for many years. Labour shortages risk leaving food rotting in the fields, barriers to trade make higher prices more likely, and more paperwork burdens fresh food exporters, slowing down exports. The sector is also held up against the stumblings of this Green SNP government. Self-inflicted uncertainty over the post-Brexit agriculture settlement is causing serious concern for a sector facing bombardment from multiple angles. 7 years on from the Brexit vote and 2 years after formally leaving the European Union, the framework bill for the post-Brexit policy is still to go through stage one of Parliament. And once the framework is in place, we will still have to await the final outcome. Crofters, farmers and growers need clarity and certainty so they can innovate, diversify, take advantage of new technologies and generally plan for the future. The introduction of the bill is long overdue. Then there was the highly protected marine areas policy, causing distress among Scotland's coastal and island communities. People in places that are reliant on livelihoods from fish catching and processing, and without which could see dramatic depopulation, as disruption felt its way through the supply chain. The hard work of individuals and organisations representing voices up and down Scotland thankfully saw off the original HPMA proposals. We await the next iteration of this policy, but the Scottish Government must work closely with coastal and island communities to ensure that, along with robust scientific evidence, the voices of those to be most impacted are not just heard but listened to. A lot of damage was done by the Scottish Government in pursuit of HPMAs, and it will take some time to rebuild trust. Then there was the Scottish Deposit Return Scheme, the DRS, a good idea, botched and then abandoned. Working together on a UK-wide DRS will help Scottish businesses who sell products across the UK. Businesses with valid concerns that the DRS would be detrimental, fear of forced closure, distraction from important day-to-day work, expense in trying to adhere to the plans. The Scottish Government will again have to build up trust among the food and drink sector and other businesses. The ferry fiasco has highlighted the need for connectivity and the impact on business and communities where it is lacking. The Northern Isles are great exporters of seafood, shellfish, salmon, Orkney beef, Shetland lamb. We produce whisky and gin too. Inter-island tunnels in Shetland would also... if I have time.
Jimmy Hawker-Johnson, briefly.
Just very quickly, I absolutely agree with the member, and coming from the Northern Isles myself, I appreciate what she's saying. Does she also recognise the importance of local abattoir facilities? Mm. I know the Shetland Livestock Marketing Group obviously operate one in there, but many of our island communities, remote and rural communities, don't have access to one. Would she agree that they're vitally important for our producers?
Beatrice Wishart, and I give you the time back.
I certainly would agree with that point. Inter-island tunnels in Shetland would help speed up export time for fresh produce to catch the nightly external ferry to Aberdeen and onward transport connections to the mainland and Europe. Some Shetland salmon finds its way to the Far East. Scottish salmon's top three markets are in France, China and the USA. But we need to balance this with greater ferry freight capacity. Around this time of year, my colleague Liam MacArthur and I speak about the pinch points in freight capacity for the livestock season, predictable but usually seemingly unprepared for by Transport Scotland. The limit of Shetland and Orkney's contribution to the Scottish and UK economy is often connectivity, transport and digital. National infrastructure investments could unlock so much more potential. To conclude, crofters, growers, farmers, aquaculture, fishing, the seafood sector, whisky, the full supply chain, even the corner shop, not to mention island and coastal communities, have all been put through the ringer by the Scottish Government in the past 12 months. That should not be how a modern, progressive, representative government acts. What comes next must be better for our Scottish food and drink sector, of which we should all be very proud. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Wishart. We now move to the open debate. I call first Christine Graham to be followed by Edward Mountain. Around 6 minutes, Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Before I elaborate on the significance to the local economy of the food and drink sector in my constituency, with examples of many small producers, and I include hospitality, which plays a significant role too, using local supplies and through its food services promoting Scottish produce, I first want to mention the impact of COVID and Brexit on the hospitality sector. The hit the sector took with pandemic closures and then restrictions was substantial, notwithstanding some financial support both at UK and Scottish Government levels. Some, such as Strobo Spa, which of course also serves food, closed completely and took the opportunity to refurbish, as did the Central Bar in Peebles, a very small pub, which could not comply with the requirement to serve food, and so it too closed, and it also just underwent some refurbishment. Indeed, some businesses have yet to see their bank balances recover, so we mustn't forget the substantial impact of COVID. Brexit too has impacted, with several of my local hotels telling me they're unable to find staff who formerly came from the EU, limiting their services to customers, though not a cheap about Brexit, from a very grumpy contribution from Rachel Hamilton. And there are businesses which pride themselves in having as much local produce in their menus as is feasible. Yes, as I've mentioned in dispatches, of course.
Rachel Hamilton.
I'm sure Christine Graham has forgotten that I have a glowing smile for her. But I want to ask her if she agrees with me that to attract more people to Scotland, we need to ensure that there is sufficient rural housing for people. We need to make Scotland an attractive place, and that means not making it the highest tax part of the UK. Yeah.
Christine Graham, I can give the
perhaps the reason Ms Hamilton didn't mention Brexit, as an independent report has shown that one third of the UK food price inflation since 2019, because of regulatory, sanitary and other border controls, has added £7 billion to domestic household bills. That's why you keep quiet about it. Turning now to the producers, small to medium enterprises, which are the backbone of Scotland's food and drink sector. There is the independent award-winning craft brewery Brottnails, a brewery established in 1979 with its range of beers in the village of Broughton. It was the first initiated Scottish microbrewery, appealing to customers looking for a new craft beer. And it celebrates and preserves traditional Scottish brewing techniques with favourites including Old Jock Scotch Ale and Stout Jock, available in pubs in Edinburgh and elsewhere. It's also available online. On the same topic, there's more beer to be had at Traquair. I have a theme, Mr Mountain. Traquair House Brewery lies in the wing of Traquair House, directly underneath the chapel. The house is extraordinary. It's Scotland's oldest inhabited house, visited by 27 Scottish kings and queens. The brewery dates back to the 1700s and was originally a domestic brewery serving the house and the estate. Disused, never dismantled, gradually just filling up with family rubbish. But it was rediscovered by Peter Maxwell Stewart in the 1960s. And today, it continues to be run by the family with beers entitled, unsurprisingly, Traquair House Ale, and the also appropriately named Traquair Jacobite Ale. It exports 50% of its production. Both businesses I've had the pleasure in visiting. I get my time back, certainly. I'm not unhappy about this.
You can get most of it back.
I don't have any samples for you.
Jamie Halkett-Johnson, briefly.
Well, I apologise for interrupting a trip through Christian Graham's Friday night pub crawl. I was just wondering how much impact those breweries were impacted by the deposit return scheme, how much preparation they had to put in, and how much in future investment that has affected them.
Yeah. Christian Graham.
Well, they've not been impacted, and you do know that I raised the issue of these businesses during DRS, and I'm not unhappy to say that, and I'm glad it's been revisited. There were issues. Yeah? So you didn't catch me out. There are producers of honey too from the large estates such as the Duke of Northumberland's Burncastle estate, where I actually passed a trailer load of hives being taken from there back to Dumfries after the bees had finished feeding off the heather. I still have a pot at home, honey, not the bees. Then there are the farms across my constituency, stretching from the Eildon Hills to the Pentland Hills, mostly sheep farming, though some mixed, such as at Baddingsgill, a hill farm in the southern Pentland Hills near West Linton. 4,000 acres of heather-covered hills populated by 1,400 hardy black-faced sheep, along with a small fold of Highland cattle. The family have farmed there since 1912, and it remains a family farm, with four generations currently living there. I would add that it's one of the many farms, and indeed estates, I've also visited in my many years here. It was on one of those Pentland farms I learned, and here I'm into dangerous territory, that on some farms sheep congregate in hefts. I hope I've remembered correctly, and hefts defend their patch with vigour. All of the above are very accessible websites where you can order, although it seems that the whole beef and whole lamb at Baddingsgill already sold out. Now, the important thing about mentioning these are businesses embedded in the community, committed to the community, committed to Scotland. They're not here today, gone tomorrow, multinationals. They don't have to get $75 million to set up a car factory somewhere in England. They are family enterprises, and they are the backbone of Scotland's economy. But back to hospitality to conclude, which I repeat endured a tough 2 years of COVID and is still on the road to recovery. Recently, I completed my annual summer surgery tour of villages, and apart from picking up lots of cases and local issues, I also, of course, had to eat. And where else? And I will mention two places. Lunch at Burt's Hotel Melrose, I recommend the Kedgeree, and at Caverston Cafe in Walkerburn, you cannot resist the homemade soup and cake. There you are, unashamedly promoting and publicising a sample of what my constituency brings to the table, and seriously, to the local and the Scottish economy, and which we should support and celebrate. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Graham. I'm sure you'll be welcome back to both hostelries. What time we had in hand has now been exhausted. I'm going to invite members to stick broadly to their speaking time allowances, and I call Edward Mountain to be followed by Michelle Thompson. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And before I start this, I would like to remind members of my register of interest in that I'm a member of a family farming partnership producing food, sadly not drink, for the people of Scotland, indirectly drink through barley, but not drink. And I also have an interest in a salmon fishery, which provides nothing as far as food to the economy. I want to start off, we often have these debates in the Parliament, which are quite interesting. We come here and we talk about how wonderful the government's doing something and how everyone else is then to blame for the failures. I think that's actually the wrong way of doing it. I think what we should be doing is coming to the Chamber and talking about the challenges that the industry face and how the government is going to address them. When it comes to agriculture, I think agriculture has risen to the challenges, and by goodness, they've had them in the last few years. Beatrice Wishart mentioned that Prices have gone through the roof. Fertiliser's gone from £265 a tonne to over £1,200 a tonne, dropping back to £600 a tonne this year. That's been reflected in seed costs, spray costs, fuel, labour costs. All of that has gone up. And it's been a real challenge for farmers. Farmers have been hanging on by their nails to the businesses that they are working in. And the problem is they're not seeing the extra costs being met by real farm gate prices. We haven't really seen the increase that we should have done. And perhaps for the consumer, that's a good thing because it's kept prices for food lower than they would be if the prices had been passed on. We've seen beef prices rise, but they're now falling. And the beef herd is indeed falling, as I think was made by my colleague earlier. And the question that was raised by Jim Walker when he came to the Ray Committee was whether it's going to be sustainable into the future. We need it sustainable, we need beef, because we can't eat trees, and we need to consider that. And when it comes to working in the farming industry, we need to understand it's not purely Brexit that's causing a problem. Finding labour has always been difficult. It's not a four-day week working on the farm, it's a full-time life working on the farm. Who wants to be up at 2 o'clock in the morning trying to deliver a difficult cow, probably getting a kick for the privilege? It's much easier working a four-day week in another sector. That puts people off working in the farming industry, but that is what farming is all about. And we need to encourage people to work in the farming sector by making it easier for new entrants. We haven't done that. We've confused the marketplace by making it difficult with new tenancy legislation. And we should have had an agriculture bill last year, Cabinet Secretary. The chairman of the Climate Change Committee said that. NFU has said it. Farmers have said it. And the only one that believes it's not required, I think, is you. Now, we've seen other industries expanding, and I think the whisky industry is a good example. It's really paid its part. It's become bigger. It's employing lots of people. But they do need to protect their primary suppliers. Their primary suppliers are thinking, is it easier to produce rye to go into an anaerobic digestion system or to produce barley? If distilleries don't make it attractive for farmers to produce barley, they will not be able to source Scottish barley. And I also have to say, I believe that the Scottish whisky industry needs to address some of the net zero problems they face, not only with the cooling water, but also the heat that they're using in their process. I want to deal with the other industry, which I find the most disappointing, and that's the aquaculture industry. I have tried during my time in this Parliament to be supportive of the aquaculture industry. There are 205 farms across Scotland, and they generate a huge amount of income. They are, without doubt, big employers. And when the REC Committee considered all the things that they brought to the economy, we were clear that they have a significant place in the Scottish food industry. But, since 2017, the amount of deaths of salmon in salmon farms have increased substantially. We are now at a stage where 36,000 tonnes of salmon are destroyed annually. That is not acceptable. It shouldn't be acceptable, and we shouldn't allow it to be acceptable. Just in this year alone, I think in the month of June, we saw that 8% of all the fish in Loch Linnhe farm died. 9.2% of all the fish in Kishorn farm died. In fact, 25% of all fish that go to sea die before they reach the table. And what's worse, some of them are dying when they're harvested and they still reach the table. I'm afraid the aquaculture industry has a lot to do to rise to the challenges. There were 65 recommendations in the REC report that asked them to rise to those challenges. And we were told by evidence from people like Ben Hatfield that they were humbled by the problems that they faced and would rise to the challenge. The only rise we've seen to the challenge in the last 6 years since he gave evidence, 5 years since he gave evidence, is a 168% increase in the use of antibiotics at sea. That, to me, is unacceptable. So, Presiding Officer, my time is short. What I would say to it in conclusion is there is much we can do, but there is much we need to do. Let's concentrate on some of the failings so we can get them right and make Scotland's food and drink industry the best in the world.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I now call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Colin Smith, up to 6 minutes. Ms. Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This year, the Royal Highlands Show, an industry-led strategy which aims for a 25% increase in turnover for Scotland's food and drink sector by 2028, was published. As an aside, I have to mention that this was the 7th anniversary of the vote to leave the EU. But of course, it isn't the first time the food and drink sector in Scotland has partnered an SNP government. Whilst there was some encouraging work done by the previous Labour-Lib Dem coalition, it was a national food and drink policy created in conjunction with the industry and led by Richard Lochhead in 2008, which set out the ambition of making the industry then worth £13 billion to the Scottish economy by 2013. And of course, for many years, it was our fastest growing sector with an emphasis on ambition, innovation, and a real drive to promote the quality of brand Scotland. That partnership helped create a feel-good factor, an attitude that the sector was important, that government was listening and valued the industry. The rapid and very visible success was at first celebrated and then viewed with just a hint of jealousy from down south. This ever-rising tide of brand Scotland carrying the banner of the Saltire and our Scottish-grown and manufactured products, the confidence and huge growth in numbers of small artisan producers and the diversification of farms were seized upon by consumers. Either access at the growing number of farmer markets and farmer shops, and then by the ultimate marketing machines, the supermarkets. And I remember the days when the likes of Tesco had huge Saltires painted on the outside of their walls and pictures of real farmers smiling into the camera hanging up in their stores. They, better than anyone, recognised the marketing potency and power of that combination. The hard-working, quality-driven farmer from Scotland with a worldwide reputation for high standards in welfare and stockmanship. This was a marketing dream to be capitalised on. Multiple products were given the brand mark. All our meat products, our game, our dairy products, and even our tablet and shortbread. Scotland's food and drink spoke of provenance and quality. And of course, this homegrown increase in output led to hugely increased exports. The quality of the products added to the branding of Scotland, and a successful food and drink sector was marketed as a land of mystery mountains, swirling peaty waters and misty hills, joined by a land of food and drink. They say imitation is the greatest form of flattery, and in 2015 we saw the substantial imitation of the Scotland food and drink strategy emerging from a UK government. In 2015, the UK government launched its very own Rule Britannia-esque Union Jack bedecked food and drink strategy, and arguably attempting to subsume brand Scotland into brand Britain. The problem for them was, and still is, that brand Scotland carries so much more weight than brand Britain. This is simply because post-Brexit Britain is not trusted on the global stage. Now, the Tory motion talks about challenges and opportunities of Brexit. Now, I wonder, I would ask what the sheep farmers in Scotland think of the opportunity with our borders now being wide open to unlimited volumes of much cheaper Antipodean lamb. The Labour motions talk of harnessing the power of the Scottish office and resetting our relationship with the EU. What they mean is business as usual. Forget about Westminster, forget about Brexit rather, just let Westminster call the shots and promote Scotland only if it suits their agenda and not when it suits our agenda. So if Scotland's biggest drink export, Scotch whisky, is to be taxed to the levels that the UK government have recently done, then the phenomenal power of that taxation should be used right here in Scotland to help our industry continue to drive innovation, resilience and ambition. It should be helping us to tackle the scourge of poverty that blights so many of their communities, not swallowed up in Brexit Britain's desperate attempts at international relevance. I wish the strategy every success. Working in partnership with this SNP government, it's clear that the industry has a massive role to play in being a driving force for good,
as Scotland progresses towards regaining our independence.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. I call Colin Smith to be followed by Karen Adam. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that Scotland Food and Drink have made the theme of this year's Food and Drink Fortnight, discovering what's on your doorstep. The summer recess has been a great opportunity for me to do just that. I've had the privilege of visiting dozens of local producers and processors, hopefully shining a light on the growing importance of that local provenance. From a visit to Galloway Lodge Preserves, along with the Food and Drink Federation, to numerous agricultural shows, country fairs, local farms, farmers' markets, fishing ports, hotels, a distillery or two with the Scotch Whisky Association, and this weekend I'll have the pleasure of attending the Stranraer Oyster Festival. It's been a delight to eat and drink my way across a wonderful region once again this summer, and I want to place on record my thanks to the food and drink sector in South Scotland. Our farmers, our fishers, shop workers, processors, wholesalers and deliverers, all part of the 18,000 food and drink businesses in Scotland, turning over £14 billion a year, employing more than 115,000 people along the way. A real success story we should be proud of. But on that journey I've had over the summer, it's fair to say there's been no shortage of issues raised. Recruitment remains immensely challenging. One major hotel I visited in the Borders told me they weren't running at capacity, not because of a lack of demand, but because of a lack of staff, and these were skilled, well-paid posts that remain unfilled. Unquestionably, the wholly inadequate immigration policy put in place by the UK government post-Brexit is having an impact, such as the short-sighted decision not to include chefs on the shortage occupation list. But changing that policy alone won't be enough. We need an end to year-on-year cuts to colleges, which is eroding that skilled workforce, better reskilling opportunities for older workers, and more campaigns such as the Hospitality Risings campaign, Rise Fast, Work Young, to highlight the often hidden positive career opportunities that exist in the sector. Unless we address the chronic housing shortage as well, especially in rural areas, I'll continue to meet businesses such as those in Dumfries and Galloway I spoke to during the summer, who told me that even when they find staff who want to take up posts, the appointments often fall through because there's no affordable housing nearby. And continued cuts to bus services in those same rural communities simply adds to the recruitment barriers many businesses face. But there's also a role for the sector in these post-pandemic times, where many people are re-evaluating their life choices. If you're still a business offering just the minimum wage and you still think zero-hours contracts are a positive destination, then frankly, you're not going to be able to recruit. In my many farm visits during the summer, the uncertainty over future funding mechanisms from the Scottish Government and the lack of detail of what will be expected of farmers in order to secure that funding remains the main concern. And there's still anger from our fishers over the shambolic handling of HPMAs. And in the small producers I met, who are the backbone of the food and drink sector in my region, not surprisingly, they highlighted the impact of cost increases caused by spiralling inflation, which many had to absorb because of that lag between cost and price rises. That's why practical support from the Scottish Government, such as reinstating the Food Processing, Marketing and Corporation Grant, is more important now than it ever has been if we're going to maintain the growth in the sector that we all want to see. And taking a more strategic approach to food and drink policy is also vital. It's disappointing that 15 months since this Parliament passed the Good Food Nations Bill, the Scottish Government have failed to publish a draft Good Food Nations plan for consultation. So I hope in our closing comments the Cabinet Secretary will tell us when we will see that draft plan. That plan needs to show how we embed farming and food production at every level of education, have a far bigger focus on procuring and promoting local food and drink. The Scottish Government, local authorities, the National Health Service and other public bodies spend over £14.5 billion a year on services, works and goods, including food. But for too long, public procurement has had too narrow a focus on price and cost reduction. We've failed to maximise the benefits of low-carbon local supply chains, which is why we should ensure discovering what's on your doorstep isn't just a slogan, but instead have a clear target of 50% for the level of local sustainable food bought by the public sector as proposed by Labour. Local procurement not only supports local businesses, it also reduces our carbon footprint and reduces poverty. The importance of food and drink goes beyond their crucial economic importance. It impacts on our health, our environment, our record on animal welfare and on tackling poverty. For far too long, far too many people in Scotland have lacked adequate access to good, nutritious food, exposing the gross inequalities that we face today. Although our food and drink sector in Scotland has grown, so too has the scandal of food poverty. It's absolutely right that we celebrate the success of Scotland's food and drink sector, and we support the continued growth of what is a good success story. But we also need to rethink how we approach access to food. The failure to enshrine in law the right to food when the Good Food Nations Bill was passed 15 months ago was a missed opportunity. This Parliament can change that by backing Labour's Right to Food Bill that Rhoda Grant will bring forward. In a nation that provides so much outstanding food and drink, it's to all our shame that so many children in Scotland still go to bed hungry at night, that the use of food banks is at record levels, and that many of those who work to put food on the tables in restaurants struggle to pay for food to put on their own families' tables. This is a scandal that needs to end.
Thank you, Mr Smith. I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Ariane Bird, just up to 6 minutes. Ms Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to speak in this vitally important debate today. I have been privileged to visit with many stakeholders from across Scotland's rural and seafood industries, from the catching to the processing to the trading and beyond. And what was clear is that their successes are essential to the Scottish economy and, of course, the local economy of my constituency of Banffshire and Buchan Coast. When the local sector thrives, so does local businesses. Families move in and support the population, and families mean labour to support education, health and many other critical public support roles. And indeed, it's not really far-reaching to suggest that our food and drink industries sustain not just our physical bodies, but it also sustains our communities and gives life to a wide range of other Scottish industries and sectors. I love the visualisation that the story of our seafood industry is woven into the rich tapestry of Scotland's history. Without it, the coastal communities like the ones I represent simply wouldn't exist. Each of them is a testament to local ingenuity and a story of a human's commitment to provide. Our seafood sector is a cornerstone of seafood, not just here, but globally. In my constituency, in Peterhead, home to the largest fishing port in the UK and Europe's largest white fishing port, it is the hive of Scotland's seafood industry. And there's been a harbour at Peterhead for more than 400 years. And throughout the centuries, the success of the town has been closely linked to the level of maritime trade and activity. As I met with representatives of the fish market, I was able to witness firsthand, very early in the morning, the enormous undertaking and organisation, which makes it apparent that it's no ordinary marketplace. It's a testament to Scotland's enterprise and its role in the global food economy. On Saturday, I had a fantastic day out at SeaFest in Peterhead, and it was great to see the Cabinet Secretary, Marie Goujon, there as well, enjoying the blue tune, as we call it. Now, for the festival being the first one, it was an incredible success. And this wasn't just a food festival, it was a showcase of what we have to offer. And by the vast attendance numbers and the diversity of those who came to visit, it was apparent that there is a hunger, excuse the pun, to celebrate what we have locally. From young to old, there was a true community spirit of pride and a desire to educate on what we have. This intergenerational conversation on issues concerning our rural communities is needed today more than ever. And at the Turriff Show in August, I met with NFUS and discussed how we can better incorporate the topics of fishing, farming and food security into our education system to entice our younger generations to continue and, of course, I'm sure, improve upon what we have. And I look forward to working with them in the years to come on that very issue. Farming and fishing are rapidly evolving industries, and what is abundantly clear is that our food and drink, particularly our seafood sector, play a leading role in supporting Scotland to thrive both at home and abroad. On a local level, the opportunities provided by fishing are invaluable. From catching to processing, packing to marketing, our blue economy offers those opportunities in abundance. And while first and foremost we are talking about food, the Scottish fish sector is essential to Scotland's soft power on the world stage. And what does that soft power look like in numbers? Well, put frankly, fish and seafood is Scotland's primary food export. In 2021, Scottish exports of fish and seafood were valued at £1 billion, or 204,000 tonnes, and accounted for 60% of the total food exports. It also accounted for 63% of total UK fish and seafood exports. And while I'd love nothing more than to reel off success after success, I must spend a moment discussing the many concerns that have been raised with me by farmers and fishers since I was elected. And if we are to ensure the security of good quality Scottish food and drink, it is incumbent on all of us in the Chamber today to listen carefully to those concerns and address them. And among them, Brexit continues to be the number one concern. The loss of freedom of movement and the free trade has done untold damage to our rural economy. Our prized seafood industry has been hit with an estimated 50% increase in the cost of packaging items sent to the EU. Some shellfish exporters have estimated that the new barriers to trade with the EU have resulted in additional costs of £500 to £600 per consignment, making some exports unviable. In fact, Seafood Scotland have told us that post-Brexit labour shortages are having a huge impact on the seafood processing sector, with many businesses, and I quote, turning down growth opportunities due to a lack of labour. If the UK government or Labour opposition in London won't listen, perhaps our colleagues could pass on the message of Mike Park, chief exec of the Scottish Whitefish Producers Association. Talking on Brexit, he said, "We were the poster boys. We wanted out. But a lot have now reassessed their enthusiasm for Brexit because it has delivered nothing. It has left some very negative legacies and hasn't provided any of the positives we were promised." In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to acknowledge the harsh realities facing the sector.
Excuse me, Ms Adam, please resume your seat for a second. Could I have less chit-chat across the benches? Thank you. Please resume, Ms Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In conclusion, I want to acknowledge the harsh realities facing the sector, but I pay tribute to all of those who have worked on pushing ahead while bearing the weight of Tory political decisions. And I say thank you for sustaining us throughout it all, and we celebrate your resilience. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Emma Harper. Ms Burgess.
Thank you. Presiding Officer. Thank you. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to speak in this important debate. And I speak in this chamber at a time, once again, when we are still deep in a climate and nature emergency. We saw what a real emergency response looks like during the pandemic. Scientists say that the climate and nature crisis will cause even more damage than COVID. So let's show the way, let's act like our future depends on it. And of course, food and drink are inextricably linked to climate and biodiversity. Our farmers and crofters know better than most how changing weather patterns affect crops, how water scarcity can impact production, and how heat stress affects livestock and dairy yields. We all noticed the veg shortages in February this year, which the British Retail Consortium put down to difficult weather conditions in the south of Europe and northern Africa. Scotland's farming, fishing, food and drink sectors is a tremendous asset to our country. Much has already been said about its £15 billion contribution to our economy and the 120,000 people it employs, many in rural communities. But to continue thriving in a climate-changing world while reducing its own significant contribution to the climate and nature crises, our food sector has to adapt. It must be fully supported and incentivized to do so. Change can be daunting, but not changing is not an option. The world is turning and we can't stand still. We all have a stake in a food system that works for the public, for the planet, and for producers. So we need a national conversation about what we want our food system to look like. Do we want to produce more of our own food in Scotland? What is the right balance between imports, exports, and self-sufficiency? Should we use more of our land to grow our own food, or do we benefit more from producing crops for whiskey and animal feed? How can we increase our resilience? The coming years will provide a golden opportunity to shape and strengthen our food system with the forthcoming agricultural bill and payment framework, just transition policies for the agriculture and marine sectors, and not least the Good Food Nation plans, which have already been mentioned. I'm proud to have played my part in shaping the Good Food Nation Act, enshrining principles like the role of a sustainable food system, resilient supply chains, and the right to food. The resulting public sector plans will be powerful tools for influencing what food is produced, to what standards, where it is sold, and how much it costs, and how it gets on our plates. For example, local authorities could establish procurement contracts with local providers of wild venison, organic fruit and veg, and selectively sourced seafood. This would give smaller producers a steady income, increase the market for these sustainable products, and encourage others to move into production, creating a virtuous circle. I'd also love to see Good Food Nation plans include support for networks like the Highland Good Food Partnership, which supports local businesses and encourages collaboration for community food growing, food banks, and tackling food waste. And tackling food waste. Networks like these show how food can really bring community together. Presiding Officer, I want to focus now on some of the primary producers of our food, the fruit and veg growers, the horticulturalists and market gardeners who work hard to grow food for our shops, our veg boxes and our dinner tables. These are key workers in green jobs, but many don't receive the public funding that our other farmers get if their farm is too small or if they don't keep livestock or depending on the type of land they farm. Fruit and veg growers deserve more support, and this should be reflected in the new farm payment framework that will follow next year's agricultural bill. It's fantastic that the Scottish Government has extended funding for the fruit and vegetable aid scheme, providing up to £16 million over the next 2 years through producer organisations. But most of this doesn't make its way to small producers. More support for market gardens and large fruit and veg farms would create thousands of good green rural jobs and contribute millions to our rural economy. It would also ensure that public money is delivering public goods, healthy, sustainable food for people in Scotland. To conclude, I want to thank everyone working in Scotland's food and drink sector. You are all playing an important role in feeding the nation and or contributing to our economy. That's why we must use levers like the Good Food Nation plans, farm support payments and other public funding wisely to support the whole sector to adapt in a changing world, to increase its resilience and to thrive as we become truly a good food nation.
Thank you, Ms. Burgess. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Finlay Carson. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate to value Scotland's world-class food and drink sector, particularly during Scottish Food and Drink Fortnight. Scotland's food and drink sector is one of the key drivers of our economy. We're fortunate, particularly in my South Scotland region, to have some of the most amazing and delicious products and pure natural resources found anywhere in the world. And I know it's been said already, but it is worth repeating. With an annual turnover worth £15 billion and overseas export sales of more than £6 billion, representing nearly a third of all UK food exports, the food and drink industry is a major contributor to Scotland's economy. There are over 17,000 food and drink businesses which employ about 129,000 people, many in remote and economically fragile rural and island communities like in Dumfries and Galloway. Presiding Officer, exports of Scottish food and drink were valued at a record £8.1 billion in 2022, up £1.9 billion, so that's 30.6% compared to 2021. However, despite the fantastic efforts of our food and drink producers, it is clear that Brexit continues to pose huge challenges to Scotland's food and drink industry due to the loss of free trade and the imposition of new obstacles to the movement of goods. Indeed, one producer in Galloway, the Ethical Dairy, stopped sending goods to Europe and Ireland altogether because of Brexit bureaucracy. It was just going to cost too much. No matter how innovative the industry or how wonderful our produce, if we cannot get it to markets, the sector will face challenges. And from attending the majority of agricultural shows over the summer, including Stranraer, Wigtown, Dumfries and Kelso, it's clear that there are numerous challenges impacting the sector. Removal from the EU single market plays a big part in that. The food and drink sector has borne the brunt of this, particularly through the loss of freedom of movement of people and free trade. Now, with clear evidence of Brexit causing food bills to rocket, we're all affected. The opposition like to point out that there are many factors influencing food inflation, but other countries and citizens do not have to contend with Brexit. It is really important that we speak about this. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government are doing all it can within its resources and powers to help the sector. Supporting our local food businesses provides important markets for local producers. The Scottish Government has provided £17.5 million to businesses and groups in the food and drink sector. And this includes the Oyster Festival in Stranraer. And I'm glad Colin Smith mentioned it because I will be going there myself this Saturday. The Oyster Festival in Stranraer has received £15,000 of combined funding from the Scottish Government and D&G Council. And again, I will be looking forward to oysters this weekend in Stranraer. It is worth pointing out that Loch Ryan is home to Scotland's only native oyster beds. And I thank Stranraer Development Trust for all their efforts in organising the Oyster Festival, which is helping shine a light on the town that I was born in and where I grew up, Presiding Officer. Scotland's ambitious 10-year collaborative food and drink recovery plan targets strong growth against Brexit impacts. Sustaining Scotland, supplying the world, Scotland's food and drink strategy aims to mitigate the damage inflicted by the COVID pandemic and Brexit. The strategy aims to support the sector to grow faster and similarly sized competitors such as in Ireland and Norway. The Scotland Food and Drink Partnership projects it could support a 25% increase in turnover for the sector by 2028, from a projected £16 billion to £20 billion. Actions include restoring promotional activity to pre-pandemic levels to reach new markets and recruiting and retaining a highly skilled workforce to adapt and tackle skill shortages in the sector. This will support rural small businesses like across D&G and the Borders. Scotland's food and drink sector lost many of the benefits it once had when trading with the EU, and this makes me crab it, Presiding Officer. While the full economic consequences of Brexit are yet to be realised, businesses now face additional expense when trading, and some food producers have found that their goods can no longer be exported to the EU. Brexit also hampers domestic production with labour shortages caused by the loss of freedom of movement. Pre-Brexit, Scottish producers sold 20,000 tonnes of seed potatoes to EU customers each year, but the Windsor framework allows the seed potatoes to go to Northern Ireland, but the EU market is still closed to Scottish seed potatoes. That's 20,000 tonnes, Presiding Officer. So many of Scotland's food industries are still suffering from lower imports and exports to the EU, including a 38% fall in fruit and vegetable exports between 2019 and 2022. So the opposition might go on about how Brexit doesn't matter. It absolutely does matter, and we have to keep reiterating it, because the sooner we're back in the EU as an independent country, the better, Presiding Officer. Scottish firms are trying to export to Europe. They face significant additional costs and bureaucracy at a time when their margins are already being squeezed. I'm about 30 seconds before I close, I think, Presiding Officer. And I hear what Karen Adam is saying about our prized seafood industry, which has been hit with a 50% increase in the cost of packaging items sent to the EU, which I know from a recent visit to a seafood company in Galloway, the new export health certificates are costing the salmon sector alone approximately £1.3 million per year. So in conclusion, I welcome the support the Scottish Government is providing to our food and drink sector, and I thank the South of Scotland producers for all their hard work, and I hope that Scotland takes its rightful place in the European Union to protect and enhance our food and drink sector. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Finlay Carson to be followed by Pauline McNeill. Mr Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to recognise the world-renowned food and drink producers across Scotland. And already heard my constituency can boast of amazing artisan cheese and ice cream makers and famous butchers in Castle Douglas. And, of course, not to forget the Oyster Festival in Stranraer taking place this weekend. And I'm looking forward to attend as well. But I've listened intently to the debate so far, and the one thing we've yet to hear from the Scottish Government is what they ultimately want our food and drink industry to deliver. The Scottish Government, long before now, should have been open and honest around what exactly their desired outcomes of the future agricultural policy is, and that includes how much food they actually want Scotland to produce. Now, we know what level of food production they want. We need to know what level of food production we want to see in Scotland for the next few decades and beyond. How many litres of milk, how many kilos of beef, lamb and pork, how many tonnes of fruit and veg and cereals. And if we knew that, we'd have a better understanding of the level of imports that the Scottish Government deem acceptable, bearing in mind the potential additional carbon footprint, the possible impact on biodiversity in relation to imported foods, and of course, given the current global situation, food security is of utmost importance. But there's been a vacuum of information from the Cabinet Secretary where we should have been hearing about a future agriculture policy outlining how she hoped to achieve her desired outcomes. Our food producers have been seeking answers for years now and have naturally grown frustrated at the lack of direction. And our Scottish food and drink producers are among the very best in the world, but are still kept in the dark about how much food they need to produce, and even basics like the government's definition of regenerative farming. But to help inform us, we need to know all this information to decide how much land is going to be needed in order that we can plan for the future with a degree of confidence. The food and drink industry in Scotland needs clear direction on future farming policies, including the use of gene editing to create, produce and create...
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving me. I think he alights on a very important point about decisions around land use, because we have a finite amount of land and there is options. So, for example, the decision between agriculture and forestry is a critical one. Is that the sort of issue that he thinks that we need to be much more focused on as we think about agriculture and land use?
Yeah,
absolutely. Thank you for that intervention. That's really helpful. It is absolutely critical to know how much food we need to produce, and then look at how much land we need to produce that food on. And you know, as you say, it's not an infinite amount of land we have, and we've got to make some really important decisions on that, and that's still unclear. But we also need to look at a clear direction on farm policies, including the use of gene editing to create produce better suited to a climate-changing Scotland and to help reduce any negative impacts on biodiversity. But this SNP-led, Green-led Scottish Government has chosen to take a narrow-minded approach and opposing the Gene Technology Precision Breeding Act, almost certainly influenced by its coalition partners in the Green Party. Sadly, and not for the good of our agriculture sector, but for constitutional reasons, this government will blindly attempt to keep pace with our European neighbours. The bill legislation would simply diverge from outdated rules inherited from the European Union by removing more precise breeding techniques such as gene editing from the scope of restrictive GMO rules and adopting a similar regulatory stance to other countries around the world, including the USA, Canada, Japan, Australia, as well as Brazil and Argentina. And despite widespread appeals from scientists, farmers and breeders, who have all highlighted Scotland's remarkable world-leading research strengths, such as the James Hutton Institute and the Roslin Institute here in Edinburgh, the Scottish Government has remained tone-deaf, steadfastly refusing to accept new technology that offers faster, more precise delivery of desired traits. And as a consequence, the many opportunities to develop more sustainable, productive and climate-resistant farming systems, which will in turn only add to Scotland's vibrant food and drink sector. I don't want to see producers going into battle with one hand tied behind their backs and their ambition to protect, and that's protect the clean, green brand of Scotland's 15 billion food and drink industry. The Scottish Government needs to come clean over its misguided hostility towards gene editing technologies with properly justifying their position, other than just a desire to remain aligned with the EU. But the EU is now changing their stance, rightly recognising the world is changing dramatically with food security increasingly more important. COVID, the war in Ukraine, the cost of living crisis, and a more aggressive climate change shift, and a growing population and demographics across the world have all sharpened the minds of the EU towards gene-edited crops. So where will that leave the Scottish Government? Will we see a massive, late, but very welcome U-turn on precision breeding issues? Will the Minister now listen to science rather than the anti-science, anti-growth, indeed anti-everything Green Party? The European Commission appears now to be moving away from its farm-to-fork policy as it realises it would be a prescription for disaster, not only increasing hunger, but undermining climate and environmental goals. Gene-editing research has moved on, with amazing policies which can reduce the input of artificial fertiliser, chemicals and water. And with the bulk of greenhouse gas emissions often incorrectly lying at the doorstep of the livestock production, GE is opening up major opportunities to improve sustainability, productivity, health and welfare of farmed animals. Should we be judicious about carefully going forward? Well, absolutely yes, but let's listen to the science, not to ill-informed scaremongering when it comes to setting food production policy. Presiding Officer, we need a food system that is efficient, productive, environmentally sustainable to provide nutritious food with an increasingly small environmental input. That can only happen if it is based in reality, not on wishful thinking.
Thank you, Mr Carson. I now call Pauline McNeill, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald. Ms McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland's food and drink industry is absolutely vital to our economic growth. Food and drink is now Scotland's biggest employer, and the industry is worth a mighty £50 billion. The food and drink that we produce from our abundant natural resources is revered around the world for its quality and its history. The production of Scots whisky and other spirit drinks is of particular importance to Scotland, and I have enjoyed, Presiding Officer, listening to the contributions and members promoting the local produce. But times have been tough for the sector. Many members have mentioned the impact of Brexit, which clearly did have an impact on the sector. Crucially, COVID-19 pandemic and many consequences flowing from that, and of course the war in Ukraine, which fueled an unprecedented cost of production crisis, which few people foresaw. But it does show the global nature of how quickly food insecurity can rise and how important it is to keep an eye on the geopolitics. Relentless market pressures and changes to the regulatory environment just to add to the many stresses within the sector. Scottish businesses are still navigating a difficult climate, and over the next few years, it is likely to remain turbulent. For many, the focus will still be on stability and remaining viable. So if I may talk a bit about my own constituency of the Glasgow region, Scotland's largest city, the hospitality industry is so critical to the supply chain of the food and drink sector, and it has been hugely exposed to rising costs, utility costs and many others, but also a lack of confidence in public transport and the huge impact that the taxi trade and the failure to properly support the taxi trade has had on cities like Glasgow, so vital to keep the beating heart of our city centres absolutely thriving. So growth and resilience is really important, and Colin Smith mentioned this in his contribution talking about the bus industry. I mean, young people rely on the night bus service in Glasgow to get home from work in the hospitality sector. Many parents driving their sons and daughters from a late shift meant that the introduction of the LEZ zone in Glasgow and the way it was done was a disaster. And now we fear the proposal, I fear the proposal of congestion charges. And it's simply because of this. Hospitality is so vital to a city like Glasgow. And if the public lack confidence to be able to come into Glasgow, or the perception that you can't, and we don't have the standard of public transport to meet the city's needs, then it will impact on recruitment and it will impact on jobs. In August, the owner of some of Scotland's most popular hospitality venues shared their concerns over the future of the industry in light of recent closures. Michael Bergeson of Bucks Bar and Thundercat pointed to the lack of rates relief still a big issue compared to England, and it's creating the impression that Scotland is not doing enough for the sector. It's an issue of great concern to me. I met with leading members of the food and drink sector in Glasgow on how to navigate the current inflationary pressures and impacts on customer spending powers, making trading difficult. I also host the cross-party hospitality group, which is diverse, including the wedding sector, the music sector and pubs and clubs, and it meets in Parliament on a regular basis. But a city region like Glasgow, which is geographically important to the sector, it is really, really important to make that connection. Some of the connection that Emma Harper and others talk about, the oyster industry, the salmon industry, and if I may mention, as Christine Graham has done, Cafe Candolfi has been there for decades in Glasgow and is a great example of an iconic restaurant serving fresh food, accessing food from all over Scotland. So I want to make sure that cafes and restaurants like Cafe Candolfi can continue to take advantage of Scotland's strong sector. I think we can take this journey by addressing that the sector is experiencing many issues that do need government support. But aside from economic growth, as others have also said, we must ensure that our food system in Scotland is contributing to the health and well-being of everyone. No matter where you live or what you earn or what your personal circumstances is, it is important that you get access to fresh food and affordable food. Food is a basic human right. And those members such as Rhoda Grant and Colin Smith and many others from other parties have championed this cause, and I think it's to their credit that they have changed the attitude to the availability of food and the concept of the right of food security. Many Scots are going to bed hungry and relying on food banks and the kindness of strangers in a country which is so rich in natural resources. I also want to mention the Glasgow Homeless Project, a wonderful organisation that is saving lives by feeding people on the streets of Glasgow. As we've heard from other members, one in three children in Glasgow are living in poverty and many of those children go to bed hungry. Food insecurity in Scotland is caused by too much poverty, not too little food. So for better access to food, particularly for those who live in multiple areas of deprivation, there must be facilities to offer a healthy choice of nutritious and fresh food. I know there are plans to increase Glasgow's food growing capacity by scaling up allotments and community growing, as well as the development of urban farming in the city. And the data shows that 20% of people referred to food banks by the Trussell Trust, the network, in mid-2022 were in working households, showing a rise in food poverty. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government promised a national plan for ending the need for food banks. We need to make sure that we focus on that. We need to focus on giving people the right to food and to focus on the viability and the sustainability of the food and drink sector. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. And I now call Gordon MacDonald, who will be the last speaker before we move to closing speeches. Mr MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In Scotland, our trade surplus in goods is driven by the fantastic world-class quality of food and drink, whether that's the abundance of seafood in Scottish water, including top-quality salmon, or Scotch beef and lamb reared on our farms. We also export soft fruits such as strawberries, raspberries and blueberries, barley, wheat, oats and, of course, whisky. The sector delivers $8 billion of export sales, which adds to that trade surplus that is generated here in Scotland. Our food and drink products are in high demand from markets across the world because we offer a diverse range of products with broad international appeal that have a reputation for quality, provenance and luxury. Scotland, and to a lesser extent Wales, are the only countries of the UK that have a trade surplus in all goods and in services, with the latest ONS figures for 2021 highlighting that we had a surplus, an overall surplus of £21 billion. We sell more to the world than we import, generating a surplus that benefits the UK economy, unlike the northwest of England, Yorkshire and the Humber, East Midlands, West Midlands, the East and southeast of England. All consume more than they produce and all have an overall goods and services trade deficit. Presiding Officer, before I focus on the whisky industry, I should remind members that I am the co-convener of the cross-party group on Scotch whisky. In 2022, the value of Scottish whisky exports was £6.2 billion, which equates to 1.67 billion bottles of whisky, or 53 bottles of whisky exported every second to markets all over the world. Scotland's whisky accounted for 77% of Scottish food and drink exports and 25% of all UK food and drink exports. The Scotch whisky industry exports to 174 countries around the world, with the largest market being in India, who alone purchased the equivalent of 219 million bottles of whisky, followed by France and then the United States. These export sales help support employment in Scotland, where 11,000 people are directly employed in the whisky industry and supports 42,000 jobs across the UK. The number of Scottish direct employment in the whisky industry is up from the 9,300 jobs estimated in 2008, as the number of distilleries has increased from 109 in 2009 to 146 we have today. The result is we have over 22 million casks lying maturing in warehouses in Scotland, the equivalent of 12 billion bottles of whisky. However, the UK government must be careful that their actions do not undermine investment in the industry. In the 2023 spring budget, the UK Chancellor increased duty on whisky by 10%, resulting in the duty and VAT amounting to 75% of the average price bottle and widening the difference between the taxation of spirits compared to other categories of alcohol. In 2009, spirit duty per unit of alcohol was 23 pence. It is now 31.6, up 43% over the last 14 years. We have a UK government that takes 75% of the cost of a bottle of whisky in tax, yet provides no support for energy costs, despite distillation being energy intensive, and the industry was excluded from the energy bill relief offered by the UK government. This increase comes at a time when year-on-year growth and profitability has been undermined by the UK decision to leave the EU, despite the people of Scotland voting to remain. Analysis highlights that 44% of businesses indicate Brexit as the main cause of difficulties in trading overseas and attracting agricultural workers, particularly at harvest time, with high inflation and energy costs impacting on profitability and creating ongoing difficult trading conditions for our food and drink industry. Brexit has also resulted in Scottish products losing their protected geographical indicator status, similar to what products such as Parma ham and champagne have. There is a new reciprocal agreement with the EU to give some protection to our products, but this will not necessarily carry the same cachet as before with consumers. Presiding Officer, I may not have any distilleries yet in my constituency of Edinburgh Pentlands. However, I'm fortunate to have the Scotch Whisky Research Institute. The institute, based at Heriot Watt Research Park, conducts research covering the entire whisky-making process. The aim is to examine all aspects of the process, from barley to bottle, to improve sustainability, efficiency, and introduce new technology where appropriate. On my visits to the Institute, I've seen how they take product safety and quality very seriously. Another aspect of their work revolves around stopping counterfeiting and protecting the authenticity of Scotch whisky. Our whisky is a premium global product, and the work of the Product Protection Group ensures that only spirit matured in oak casks in Scotland for at least 3 years can be called Scotch whisky. Presiding Officer, given the importance of Scotland's food and drink industry to the Scottish and UK economy, I welcome the £5 million the Scottish Government is investing in the new strategy and its ambition to support the industry's aim to grow turnover by 25% by 2028.
Thank you, Ms McDonald. We will now move to closing speeches, and I call on Daniel Johnson to close on behalf of Scottish Labour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. So this debate might have been about the resilience of the food and drink sector, but I think if there's one theme that genuinely united the Chamber, it was this, is that we might be talking about resilience, but actually food and drink represents a real strength in Scotland and a huge opportunity for the future, and of that there is no doubt. Now, it gave me great pleasure to attend the Food and Drinks Awards last Thursday at the Conference Centre, and that was very much the theme of one of innovation, real dynamism, and I think real entrepreneurialism right the way across the sector. Although I have to say, even though it was at a dinner, that many categories did make you feel very, very hungry, no matter how much you ate. But what is clear to me is that this is a sector that is a part of Scotland's future. And I think a number of members have rightly mentioned the whisky industry. But I think it's worth putting some of those facts into some context. Because, yes, whisky is one of our top exports, but it represents 25% of all UK food and drink exports and 1.5% of all UK exports, full stop. Whisky is a real global success story. What's more, we have the real benefit of having a category of drink that is synonymous with this country. That is something that countries around the world would have their arms off in order to achieve. But there is still more we can do. While that is a success story, if you look at other countries such as France, while the food and drink is worth some 5% by employment in this country, in France it's worth 15%. And I think it's a good example, because France is a country that has delivered both quality in its food produce, but also scale. So our question, our challenge, is how do we do that? How do we achieve that sort of scale of food and drink in terms of its economic contribution? How do we get other categories, like whisky, to that level where it's synonymous with this country and seen as a real strength? And that's what I would like to focus on as we look at this industry going forward. But I think it's also important to reflect on some of the other points. I think particularly my colleagues Rhoda Grant and Colin Smith were absolutely right to concentrate on security and the links between food and poverty. Because while we're in amidst a cost of living crisis, we have to focus on the fact there are many in this country who cannot afford to eat. And I think it is something that we should consider, where 40% of our food is imported, as Rhoda Grant pointed out. I think setting targets for local authorities in terms of their food procurement would do a great deal, because we cannot ignore the links between food, poverty and health. And at a time when we see rising obesity, where we see lowering life expectancy, thinking about the quality of the food and making sure that it's affordable is absolutely key, as Colin Smith pointed out. I'd also like to highlight the contribution of Edward Mountain, because I think he said something really quite important, is that while we may be focused on our success, we also need to be very realistic about the context and the challenges. And yes, salmon is a major export, right up there with whisky, but we cannot ignore, I think, some of the real issues that industry throws up, the wastage. And I think he was right to highlight the recommendations of the REC committee. And I think I would encourage people in that industry to look at it. But it is a strength. What we need to do is find a way of making our aquaculture sustainable so we can be truly proud of it and I think, ensure that it continues to make a contribution. But in terms of that realism, unfortunately, there was much of this debate which seemed to lapse into some of the usual confusion around borders that we see from both the Conservative front bench and the SNP front bench. So we had the slightly absurd, I think, assertion from Rachel Hamilton that somehow gene editing was the cure to all the border issues and the delays that exporters are facing here. And frankly, I think that is absurd. But likewise, from the SNP, the assertion that somehow all those problems of the delays, the bureaucracy that we experience at the South Coast are somehow disappear if we take those problems and place them in Gretna. That equally is nonsense. Just in a moment. In order to be credible in this, you have to face the fact that exporting has become a hugely more difficult chance, a proposition for especially small and medium exporters. In a recent Financial Times reportage on this, I listened to one tea producer stating that the length of time it takes to get goods to Europe has gone from 2 days to 21. Now, if Rachel Hamilton can explain how gene editing solves that, I'll give way to her now.
Rachel Hamilton.
There are many benefits of gene editing, and you clearly weren't listening to the message within the speech about gene editing. What I would like to know is, does Scottish Labour agree with Scottish Conservatives, and would they like to bring forward a gene editing bill, or would they like to align with Europe?
Tanya Johnson.
On that, I think we have to be absolutely led by the science. And I think gene editing does, I think, have a great number of things to look at. and particularly around sustainability, ensuring that we have crop yields. But to say that it is an answer to border problems is frankly absurd. What's more, I'm deeply concerned by any proposition that we deviate from keeping pace. Ultimately, food products need to be exported to countries that are close to you. If we increase the barriers to exporting to Europe, we are just going to make that task more difficult. But likewise, we only have to look at DRS and the very real issues thrown up when those proposals to look at what problems borders cause. We were facing the very real proposition that Scottish brewers were not going to sell their products in Scotland because of having differential labelling between Scotland and the rest of the UK. So do not pretend for a second that the issues caused by borders are replaced or solved by creating additional borders. They do not. You compound those problems. So we have, I think, nonsensical thinking from both the front benches and the Conservatives and the SNP. Ultimately, I would just like to end on this. Food and drink is a huge strength for Scotland, genuinely part of Brand Scotland, as Michelle Thompson. But I think we need a joined-up plan that where it's integrated with the rest of economic policy and indeed a comprehensive industrial strategy if we're going to make good at it. And maybe next year the Secretary for the Economy will join his colleague on the front bench at this debate.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I now call on Jamie Halker-Johnson. Mr Halker-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by drawing members' attention to my register of interest as a partner in a farming business of J. Halker Johnson & Sons and as a member of NFU Scotland and Scottish Land and Estates. And I'm pleased to be able to close this debate for the Scottish Conservatives, a debate on a subject which is obviously very close to my heart, but also so vital to my Highlands and Islands region. As my colleague Rachel Hamilton rightly said in her opening remarks, while MSPs may disagree on today's motion and amendments, we all recognise that Scotland is blessed with a world-class food and drink sector, with people and communities right across our country, from Selkirk to Shetland to Stornoway, producing the highest quality food and drink, which is enjoyed right across the world. In a previous role as an advisor to various MSPs, I was never prouder than when one of them would visit Orkney, my home, and enjoy firsthand the fantastic food and drink on offer. Jamie McGrigger, in particular, would wax lyrical of the quality and the variety of produce available at the Orkney County Show. And folk from communities right across the Highlands and Islands and across Scotland can boast the same of their own local area. So we are right to celebrate Scotland's food and drink sector, as at least the first few lines of the Scottish Government's motion does. But then, of course, disappointingly, if not unexpectedly, we get into the politics of it. Politics which mean everything to Scottish Nationalist ministers and absolutely nothing to Scotland's farmers, fishermen and food and drink producers. And while it seems the Scottish Government to take this line and factors such as leaving the European Union and the impact of Russia's illegal invasion of Ukraine cannot and should not be ignored, SNP ministers also cannot ignore their own role in creating increased uncertainty for Scotland's farmers, fishermen and others from across the food and drink sector through their own policy platform. As Rachel Hamilton and others have rightly pointed out, we still don't know the details of the agricultural bill, with those of us who live and work Scotland's land wondering how our sector will be supported going forward. Farming in places like Orkney, as it is with many of the communities across my region, can be hard enough without a government in Edinburgh which still won't tell us what hoops they want us to jump through. So perhaps the Cabinet Secretary will tell us how we should invest in our farms when we still don't know how that will be funded. But as important as it is, it's not just about funding. Too often it is because of this Scottish Government's own policy agenda that businesses are being forced to adapt. As I mentioned earlier, farming communities like mine in Orkney have been left without abattoir facilities in the islands. Many of those who farm on Scotland's islands are left relying on increasingly unreliable ferry links to get produce to markets. Some are limited in their ability to sell online because the SNP's R100 broadband project hasn't and probably never will reach them. Even farm diversification, particularly around agritourism, risks being hit by damaging plans to introduce short-term lets licensing, which, designed to deal with the problem in Edinburgh, could impact most in rural Scotland. Agriculture is not a priority for this Scottish Government. And let me give this one example, which helps highlight it. Again, in Orkney, £6 million is being spent eradicating stoats. Now, I support this initiative, and we agreed early on to allow traps to be sighted on our farm. But does the Cabinet Secretary understand why many local farmers are so frustrated when millions are spent on the stoat problem? while funding to control the numbers of grey-lag geese, which are causing serious damage to agricultural land for many farmers on many of our islands, runs to only tens of thousands of pounds. Farmers, as we always have done, are facing these challenges head on. But we're doing so with a government that has, as a coalition partner, a party which sees agriculture as the enemy, which demonises our fantastic red meat sector, that instead of promoting a brilliant, healthy, homegrown produce, would talk it down, restrict its consumption, or even see it banned. It's little wonder that so many farmers have lost faith in this SNP Green Nationalist government. But it's not just our farmers. Because the Scottish Government appears at almost every turn to be working against the interests of rural and coastal communities and the local businesses that support so many jobs and livelihoods. The plans for HPMAs were ill-considered and rejected by coastal communities who recognised the damage they would do. The plans have now been dropped for now, but given how readily the Greens accepted this U-turn, it's understandable that many feel this was simply beleaguered nationalist ministers kicking the can down the road for reintroduction at a later date. And talking of kicking cans down the road, how many millions of pounds and how many hundreds of thousands of hours of time have been wasted because of the Scottish Government's determination to push ahead with their ill-thought-out plans for a deposit return scheme? We know that it's left the taxpayer out of millions of pounds out of pocket, but how many small businesses were forced to prepare for a scheme that was then dropped, paying out thousands, sometimes hundreds of thousands of pounds to make changes to their businesses that they won't see any return on anytime soon, if at all? That's millions of pounds across the sector that is now lost to future investment. Presiding officer, having experienced the events we have over the last few years, no one should need explaining to them the importance of securing and enhancing our food security. That is why our amendment highlights the benefits of gene editing. The UK government has led on gene editing, recognising the opportunities it brings, not only from a food health and security perspective, but also the economic opportunities too. As colleagues have said, even the European Union appears now to be moving slowly towards that position. Scotland, with our fantastic research and innovation base, is well placed to take advantage of this new approach, but the Scottish Government must get behind it. And while I appreciate the Scottish Greens will not support our position on gene editing, their increasingly isolated position and views on this are well known, those in the SNP who are from an agricultural background or who represent rural Scotland, our farmers and our crofters, should recognise that there is nothing in our amendment today that they should disagree with. And so I'd hope that, at decision time, they could support our amendment. But of course, they probably won't. Because while the Scottish Conservatives are putting Scotland's rural and coastal communities at the centre of our policy agenda, placing food production at the heart of the new agriculture bill, investing in producers to keep food prices affordable for consumers, boosting support for technology and innovation, SNP MSPs will follow their whip and vote with their Scottish Green colleagues because they are now beholden to their anti-business, anti-rural nationalist bedfellows.
Yep.
And rural Scotland sees that.
Thank you, Mr. Halkett-Johnson. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Mary Gushaw to wind up the debate on behalf of the Scottish Government and take us to decision time, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I do want to firstly offer my thanks to members right across the Chamber this afternoon for their contributions to this debate, because I think it's clear from the range of interventions that we've heard, we can see the level of challenge that the sector faces at the moment, but of course it continually rises to meet them with energy and ambition. And I think one particular highlight, and starting off with the positives of the debate as well, and I think any time we have a debate in relation to food and drink, I think one of the highlights of it are the many examples that members showcase from their own constituencies and hearing about the great work that's happening right across Scotland. And I would just pick up on Rachel Hamilton's examples that she mentioned in her opening contributions. Hardy's Mill and Peel and Farm, two farms that I'm very familiar with, both of which I've visited. And I think that they're fantastic examples, not just of because of the amazing quality of the produce that they provide as well, but also because of the sustainable and regenerative farming practices that they really showcase there as well. We had a nice little tour of Christine Graham's constituency too, It was fantastic to hear Canon Adam talk about the importance of the fishing industry and Peterhead Sea Fest, which took place at the weekend. She is very right. It was the blue tune at the weekend, and it was great to see such a fantastic turnout for that event and that real celebration of what Peterhead has to offer. And it was also really good to hear from Colin Smith, from Emma Harper and Finlay Carson about this cross-party delegation that we're going to be sending to Stranraer at the weekend. So I look forward to our impromptu cross-party group that will be taking place there. Now, as ever, there were so many important points that were raised during the course of the debate today, so I do want to make sure that I cover as many of those as possible. Firstly, I would like to turn to the discussion on the Good Food Nation. And the Good Food Nation Act itself has been raised by a few members in their contributions today. And I think there are some key points from those that I want to cover. Now, we have a vision of Scotland as a Good Food Nation, and I'm really looking forward to launching our consultation on the National Good Food Nation Plan. Because that plan is going to be wide-ranging, it's going to be cross-cutting, and it's going to reflect the spectrum of food-related issues that contribute to our nation's social and economic well-being, the environment, people's health and physical and mental well-being, economic development, animal welfare, education and child poverty. And I remain fully committed to Scotland as a place where everyone here takes an interest in their food, where the food sector workers are committed to serving and selling good food, where everyone in Scotland has ready access to healthy, nutritious food, where dietary-related diseases are in decline, and where we produce our food in a way that is sustainable and works for both climate and nature. Yes, I will.
Colin Smith.
Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary when we will see that draft plan actually published, because it has been 15 months since the bill was passed?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would respond that we are still on time and on schedule, though, in terms of the timescales that we'd set out for publishing that. So I will be setting out the detail on that in due course, and that will be coming forward shortly. Now, continuing on from the Good Food Nation, that goes hand in hand with our commitment to local food for everyone, supporting that locally based production and circular supply chains, cutting food miles and enabling more people to enjoy food grown locally, while also delivering on our Trading Nation export strategy, as well as the visions that we've published, our vision for agriculture and sustainable aquaculture too. Now, I know that Rachel Hamilton and Rhoda Grant referred to what they saw as missed opportunities within the Good Food Nation Act. However, what the Act did do was create that overall framework. And I think where we really will make that difference across many of the points that have been raised today and bring together these key areas of food policy is in the Good Food Nation plan itself. And that was always the intention. And as I've outlined, I really look forward to launching the consultation on the draft plan and getting that feedback. Sorry, I do need to make some progress. I do want to come back to Rhoda Grant's contribution, though, and I would say that between Rhoda Grant, Colin Smith and Daniel Johnson as well, I'm very much in agreement with a lot of the points that they'd covered in the debate today, and actually mostly what they'd covered in their amendment. But I want to touch on the right to food that Rhoda Grant mentioned in particular, because I know, as the member will be aware, we had many discussions on this when it came to the passage of the Good Food Nation Bill. The right to food is a fundamental human right, and this government has committed to incorporating that right into Scots law, but doing that through the forthcoming Human Rights Bill. Now, that bill is the appropriate place to do that because of the complex interrelationships between rights and obligations across the four treaties, and that's why we want to bring that together in a single, coherent and integrated framework. So I am happy to reaffirm that commitment today because we want to strengthen domestic legal protections by making these rights enforceable in Scots law. Yes.
Rhoda Grant.
Will the Minister empower the Food Commission to bring into reality a right to food? We have a right to food now, it is a human right, but actually we look around and see so many of her citizens not being able to access food. Will she charge the Food Commission to actually make this a reality for people?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, that is where we also set out, as part of the passage of the Good Food Nation Act, to recognising the right to food and the fact that through that plan, that's what we're ultimately giving effect to. But again, I'm more than happy to continue this conversation with Rhoda Grant, given the Member's Bill that I know she's proposing as well. And I know that this is a vitally important topic. So again, I'm more than happy to follow up with you in discussions in relation to that. Again, I am still continuing to focus on Rhoda Grant's contribution and Colin Smith too, because they really did highlight so many important points, and I'm in full agreement, in agreement with much of what was said, particularly in relation to the points raised on poverty. The fact that we have so many people dependent on food banks in a nation which is rich in so many ways, and not least in terms of the quality of the food that we do produce. And I think when you also consider the figures that we have around food waste, I mean, they're truly shocking and problems that we really have to try and address. And there is one point, though, I would like to clarify. I know that Rhoda Grant mentioned the plan to end the need for food banks and was requesting more detail on that. The first plan was published on the 5th of June this year, but I'd be happy to follow up and provide more of the details there. Procurement, again, a hugely important area which has been raised by a few members today. And ultimately, I do think this is an area where there is agreement between us all and where we do ultimately want the same thing. However, it is a very complex area at the same time. The legislation that governs procurement is complicated and it prohibits any discrimination against imported produce. But within that, that's why we've provided broad support measures to ensure local producers can access public sector contracts, including the Supplier Development Programme, with up to £150,000 over the course of this financial year, and the Food for Life Programme, which is now operating across 17 local authorities to support more locally sourced, healthier food in schools. And we also have a Glasgow-based pilot on expanding the Food for Life principles across the public sector. And we funded that with £490,000 of funding over the course of this year. And we further committed to updating Catering for Change, which will set out the principles in relation to sustainable procurement of food and catering services in the public sector to align procurement behind sustainable low-carbon farming and food. Now, Rhoda Grant and Rachel Hamilton mentioned what they would propose in relation to targets, and we just to say that we will be investigating that, and more detail will, of course, follow alongside other work on the Good Food Nation plan. I think touching on another point that Colin Smith raised in terms of some of the concerns he picked up from his region, and I wanted to touch on the Food Processing and Marketing Cooperation Grant being one. I know how important that scheme is to businesses, and I've heard these concerns directly. Now, unfortunately, we did have to put a pause on that scheme due to pressures on the Scottish budget this year. However, we took the opportunity during this time to carry out an independent review of the scheme through Scotland Food and Drink to see how we can identify how it can best meet the needs of Scotland's food processing sector within the new reality of single-year funding. So that review is now concluded, and we'll be carefully considering the recommendations that have come about as a result of that. Now, another, again, really important point that I want to touch on today, and again raised by quite a few members across the chamber, is the focus on our primary producers, our farmers, crofters and fishers, without whom we wouldn't be here having this debate today. Now, in terms of the calls for clarity and detail in agriculture, I know that members will be well aware, and we have discussed this at length in previous debates, that we are working closely with our farmers and with our crofters to co-develop our work in agriculture, to make sure that we have policy that works, that is deliverable, and that does what we need it to do for food production, for climate and for nature. And again, as I've already previously set out too, that co-development takes time. Now, what we have done, though, is we've set our direction and the future direction of travel, which we published in our Vision for Agriculture, and we published that last year. We've published our route map outlining when the key decision points are, when information will be available, and what support is available now. And with that, we also published a definition of regenerative farming that Finlay Carson asked for in his contribution. We've announced the conditions for support that will be implemented from 2025. Now, Ariane Burgess also raised an important question in her contribution and raised important points in relation to how we support small producers going forward. Now, this is something we are committed to do. I really do need to make progress, and I'm approaching my closing comments. And I think it would also address some of the points in the previous interventions made by Jamie Halcrow-Johnson on the importance of abattoirs and the importance of those facilities across Scotland. Now, we have been doing work on a small producers pilot, which has included a survey on abattoirs to better tailor the support that we have going forward. So that work is continuing, but I just wanted to highlight that these are very important points that we are considering going forward, because we know supporting our small producers is hugely important. And I think just one final point I want to touch on too. Edward Mountain, who I would say normally when I've been in debates with him has made quite considered contributions. Unfortunately, it didn't feel so considered today with some utter nonsense. And also I would say from Jamie Halcrow-Johnson in relation to the commitments around a future agriculture bill, which in line with our published commitments, we will be introducing this year. But we touched on aquaculture. Now, aquaculture, as has been identified, is a significant contributor to our rural economy, providing those well-paid jobs. We see a future for this sector in Scotland, and that is why we published our vision for sustainable aquaculture, which I think addresses some of the concerns that have been raised previously by the committee. But we do see a strong future for that industry going forward. And just to conclude, I would want to reiterate that our food and drink sector is a Scottish success story. We can't stand still. Yes, there are challenges, but the industry strategy rightly shows that resilience, sustainability and growth can go hand in hand. We have a fantastic larder on our doorstep and our waters on our land and the fantastic local producers to make the most of them. So I would call on each and every person in the chamber to join me in celebrating them as they so richly deserve. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on celebrating the resilience of Scotland's food and drink sector. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Business Motion 10419 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a change to the business programme. And any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore. The question is that motion 10419 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business, and the first is that amendment 10406.2 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, which seeks to amend motion 10406 in the name of Marie Goujon on celebrating the resilience of Scotland's food and drink sector, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.